Hi, everyone. Ooh, this is big. Okay, so I'm Erin Griffith of Fortune, and I'm going to give you a quick rundown of the format of this debate before we get started. So I'm going to give each of our speakers a six-minute opening statement, and then we're going to have some open debate and some closing statements. Pretty straightforward. But before and after the debate, I'm going to take a audience vote to see if our speakers have changed anyone's minds and to determine a winner. So as discussed, the motion for debate is, do entrepreneurs need a God complex to drive innovation? Can I see a show of hands of people who agree that yes, entrepreneurs need a God complex to drive innovation? Raise your hand if you agree with this motion. Okay, all right. Bit of a minority here. All right, and on the other side, who think that entrepreneurs do not need a God complex? Let's see a show of hands. Okay.
How many of you would just rather be drinking?
Yeah. The whole country.
At least 20%, okay.
Yeah. I think we've learned that debates don't matter anyways, what people think after last night.
Topical. All right, so arguing in favor of the motion is Ryan Smith. He's the co-founder and CEO of Qualtrics. It's a Utah-based research software company with a startup, or with a valuation of over $1 billion, and it is also a rumored IPO candidate.
Rumor.
And arguing against the motion, we have Dave McClure, founder of 500 Startups, accelerator investment fund, has backed more than 1,500 startups, correct, in more than 50 countries. So
wow. That's pretty good, right?
Yeah.
Writing checks is not necessarily a measure of virtue. Money coming back in is probably better KPI.
All right, so let's start with our opening arguments. Who wants to go first? For, against? All right, Ryan, why don't you kick us off? You
have well, that was quick. He won with just scissors.
Oh, wait, we're going to do paper, rock?
No, we're good. We're good.
You guys are stalling. All right.
All right.
Go ahead.
No, we're good.
Your opening argument.
So first of all, this is an interesting topic. I think the world of a founder is probably one of the most unique worlds that someone could go into. How many founders do we have out there? Okay.
All the ones that raised their hands.
All the ones that raised their hands before that said you need a God complex. So look, I don't know about a God complex, but you definitely need a complex of some sort. And if you don't have one, you will get one very quickly. So, you know, I believe the founders need to do godlike things. And a couple of those things that I can think of just right off the bat are, first of all, you have to be a creator. To be a founder and to innovate and an entrepreneur, you have to create something. I think the second is you have to herd the masses who all want help. And that's a big part of being a founder or an entrepreneur. And then the third is you have to be original, which is probably the hardest part of being an entrepreneur and innovation. So does that mean that you have a God complex? It's definitely a complex of some type. And to be honest, there's some things that are different than God in starting a company or being innovative. First is when you're an entrepreneur in tech, you've got to be creating all the time. It's not a one-time event. And then I think there's some other differences. For example, I think God rested on the seventh day, and I don't think we do a very good job in tech at resting. And so that's why CEOs average about a 7-year lifespan in tech, and most great companies are created and, you know, they take a little bit longer than that. And so that's a huge problem that we have in tech is charging your own batteries. I don't think that being a founder and an entrepreneur is a sane thing to do. If I look at our peer group of founders who are running billion-dollar companies, not many of them are very sane. And I think that that is some sort of a complex that you're developing. You have public failure. Everyone knows if you're going to succeed. You have to be resilient. It's you against the world constantly. And there's example of after example. Product market fits hard, so you're either before the market or after the market. And so I think there's definitely a complex that you have to have as an entrepreneur.
You got like two more minutes if you want to.
No, I'm good.
Okay, tapping out. All right, let's hear your opening. All right.
Hey, no clapping in this debate. No clapping. Shh. We got a lot to go through. Should I stand behind him? Should I stand behind him?
You can stalk behind me. That seems to have been effective for other debaters recently. There's definitely, I guess I should say, earlier this morning I was a little bit robotic and a little bit in my shell, so I'll try and be a little bit more animated this afternoon. I think people mistake the role of passion or religion in being an entrepreneur, particularly first-time entrepreneurs think they have to be a god or think that they have to be this impressive leader. And I think the role of the entrepreneur is probably not one of being a god. The role of the entrepreneur is probably more one of being a prophet or being a shepherd or someone, if you want, who creates a cult, who creates a village that takes them with them. The difference between someone who thinks that they're a god or wants to be a god is that that energy is focused on them and not their team or their company or their customers. I do think you have to be passionate. I think you have to be messianic. I think that you want to tell a story that creates passion with your team and your customers, and that they feel that they're part of that vision and want to walk with you, hopefully not off a cliff, but that they will follow you or even lead for you. I don't think the role of an entrepreneur is to be a god, and often I think that that leads to probably a fair amount of destruction. And I can name a few examples of that, but I'll name some ones that I think maybe aren't the ones that you're going to think of. Apple and Microsoft were both founded with people who are very, very strong founders, visionary founders, if you will, people who ran those companies for 10, 20 years. However, if you look at those companies after those founders left, there maybe is a drop-off in the religion that those teams were following. I don't think that people who feel that they have to be godlike creatures necessarily pass on those godlike qualities very well. Whereas if you look at founders who have created more of a religion, more of a story, more of a community, those types of companies are more likely to have success after those founders leave and not just be based on one founder who thinks that they are God. I'll leave with one other final remark. For those who are familiar with the company Oracle and Larry Ellison, who is an amazing founder, there's a story about Larry that many people say, which is, what's the difference between Larry Ellison and God? And the answer is, God doesn't think he's Larry Ellison.
Sounds pretty good.
All right, we got a lot of religious undertones here. poking a few holes in the myth of the founder. But I want to start by hearing some more real-world examples. So, Ryan, why don't you tell me about a few times when you used your inner God complex to help your company innovate and move forward?
So that's a good way to describe it, as the inner God, because I think it's right. There's the outer God complex, which can be good and bad depending on where you're working or where you're at. And, you know, there's probably an argument that, you know, had Steve Jobs or Bill Gates not had that arrogance, that ego, whatever they were, you know, projecting off, they wouldn't have got there and people wouldn't have jumped behind them. So I think if you
So Dave, you were saying that actually the companies were more successful after these people left.
I think that you would measure the success of Microsoft for the 10 years or so that Steve Ballmer was running the company after Bill Gates left, at best, maybe a B- and probably quite
worse.
Yeah, that's
just a bad hire.
So God's fallible then? Because if Bill Gates was God, he made a bad hire?
Well, I don't know that he's God. I think he has God-like attributes, or in a way where he, whatever it was that he was projecting helped the market or the people follow him. And I think a great example of that would be like Jack Dorsey and Twitter, right? I mean, here he is running two companies, but when he jumps into the helm of Twitter, for a while, there was like comfort there.
I think that's a good analogy because actually, if you look at Twitter, Twitter really had three gods, so it was sort of a trinity between Ev Williams, Jack Dorsey, and Dick Costolo. So yes, that is kind of, you know, the Father, the Holy Son, and the Ghost, I guess. But I would probably say that Jack was the Ghost.
All right, I hope we're not offending anyone with these
analogies. We'll leave that there. All right. So look, I think that
What about the founder of Theranos? I hate to rip on a woman because I actually want to provide positive examples, and I've had several of those that have done extremely well, but I think that you might suggest that Theranos is a company that was sort of built around someone who looked at themselves as kind of a god.
Well, she actually dressed like Steve Jobs.
I think maybe she thought she was the second incarnation of Steve Jobs.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't comment there. but I will tell you this.
Wait, so you think Theranos was a great company?
I think it was like...
You think that herself as a leader of that company contributed positively to that company? Or do you think that it created a false sense of godhood that attracted a shit ton of money and created a tremendous amount of destruction for the investors and the employees and the customers of that company, which is why Walgreens wants $140 fucking million back? Was that a good thing?
I don't think it's a... So, first of all, I think...
How about that god? Let's have another one of those gods.
So, I think, first of all, investors need to operate at their own risk. I mean, if you've got a company that fast, you're either going to make it big or you're going to lose your money. And I don't feel bad for investors that are betting on a company that are growing that fast without a proven track record. I mean, who did the diligence there? Right? A lot of people got screwed.
Not that many
people. So you're blaming the investors over
the... No, I just don't feel bad for the investors because there's a lot of companies that have that same height, that same complex, and have done great things. I think you've got to have a little bit of a God complex if you're Snapchat and you turn down X amount of dollars to go create something better and now you look like a genius. And look at every other investor, every other company that might not have had enough of a God complex to think they're going to go do it alone. I remember early on at Qualtrics, someone came in and offered us a huge check. And there was just a couple of us, and it was go-home money. And the person asked me, as I turned them down, probably the hardest thing that we have ever done, why do you think you're going to be so successful? There's got to be a little bit of God complex in there to be able to do an insane thing that any human being shouldn't be doing. I had no right to do it. In reality, it was more of because my wife said it was too young to retire and you're going to work for the rest of your life. And
that doesn't sound like God complex. That sounds like...
rationale. Well, that's how we work with it.
So what I want to know is where do you draw the line between, irrationally turning down money and ending up like a Theranos where you're maybe, breaking the rules and going too far?
That's just a lapse in
integrity. Can I rebut that one argument for just a second? We're looking at survivorship bias and the people who turn down large amounts of monies and then become successful later. Of course, we know about those stories because they became successful.
Well, no, let me tell you.
We don't hear about the stories about people who turned down $1 billion and then fucking did nothing because those aren't the stories that are told in a survivorship bias type of work.
Yeah, but
if we looked at Steve Jobs' career in the first act, he basically drove Apple into the fucking ground, was fired, started Next, and was unsuccessful with Next as well.
It's true. We cherry pick the myth, and that is a problem. But all right,
Qualtrics started. We started in a basement. We had no money and we bootstrapped for 10 years. No VCs were floating around Provo, Utah saying, hey, I want to give you $1 billion. It wasn't a way. Not only that, we sat in a basement and we targeted the academic market. It's probably one of the worst business models you could think of. No one was going to bet on that. And we had this belief that if we got the academics using our product around the world, then at some point people would graduate and go into the enterprise. It took 3 years longer than we thought. I had employees who weren't on board. I had people around me that weren't on board. There were founders that weren't on board. Everyone who was looking at this model said, this isn't going to work. Well, the downturn happened, 2007, 8, and 9. Everyone graduated. They stopped outsourcing, and Qualtrics took off, and now we have 9,000 brands. So not having a God complex, I think, works until you've got dissension or people aren't believing. And a great example of this recently is Elon Musk. Everyone looked at Elon and said, why are you buying Solar City? This makes no sense. It's insiders. It's your cousin's company. No one could understand it, and he just sat there and took it. And then all of a sudden, he comes out with this new shingle tile that goes on the roof, and everyone's like, oh, my gosh, that's going to power my house and then charge my car. You're a genius.
I think the story of Elon Musk is a great example, because if you look at Elon Musk's history, actually up until maybe recently, he wasn't always viewed as such a genius. The first company that he started was a company called Zip2. It was similar to Yelp. That was a reasonably interesting company. It was acquired for several hundred million dollars in the late 90s, early 2000s. That company didn't exist about a year later. If it was so goddamn valuable, why didn't it exist a few years later? Later, he created a company that was part of the original PayPal. Actually, Elon created X.com. Elon's often quoted as a founder of PayPal because his company was merged with PayPal and he was one of the largest shareholders. Not so well known is the story that as the CEO who took over the combined merged entity, Elon went on vacation one day. There was a palace coup, and Elon came back from vacation, and he wasn't CEO anymore. Actually, it turns out that Peter Thiel became CEO again, Max was CTO, and it turned out the business model that really drove PayPal's success was not X.com, started by Elon, it was the PayPal model that was created by Peter and Max, and also maybe a few other folks.
So what's
your
point?
Elon's money that actually got him, you know, that stake in PayPal, not necessarily his visionary genius. In fact, it was arguably his visionary genius that got him ejected from that company.
All right, let's stop talking about the successes. Why don't you tell me of some examples of companies that you work with where their ego gets in the way of their success, and how often do you see that? Is it more often, or is it infrequent?
I'm going to tell you about a company that's not driven on a God complex that's had success.
Okay.
One of my favorite companies is a company called SlideShare that was started by a husband, wife, brother team. The CEO was Rashmi Sinha. She was a woman. She was an Indian. She was an immigrant. She was a PhD. Her husband, John, was the CTO of the company, and her brother ran product development for the company back in India. That was a company that was kind of based on a family. None of them thought that they were God. That company had a very tough time raising capital because most investors did not see a minority woman as a CEO candidate. They didn't really like the fact that they were a family. They thought that was going to create all kinds of problems. That company raised about $3 million. Grew itself to a large, substantial size, had tens of millions of users, and LinkedIn acquired the company for over $100 million. Very efficient use of capital, extremely great for both the team, the company, their customers, the founders. That product is still in use today as part of LinkedIn and continues to grow. They were not gods. They were normal people who were more of a family and took that family with them and had a great outcome and success.
Yeah, I think, look, I started Qualtrics with my brother and my father. And we were a family-run business.
Holy Trinity or not Holy Trinity?
No, it was a little dispersed. We had there was four of us that did this. And I think that if you really think towards product folks, there's a pivotal moment. My brother was at Google. He was there for 7 years, and he's a true product genius. He's one of those people that touch a product and it can create billion-dollar products. And there's a couple of these folks in the world. And here we were in 2008 and 9. We were killing it. We'd never have revenue so high. This was finally looking like a business. We were cash flow positive. Investors were reaching out. We kind of made it, we thought. And he walks in and he's like, it's all crap. We're tearing the whole thing down and starting over. This isn't going to scale. And I sat there and I said, you're wrong. We actually ended up getting in a fist fight at a restaurant over this principle. No one believed him. No one. But he held resilient to his belief in the core belief, and we re-architected our entire system and started from scratch, and we would not even be close to where we were today because he was right. And I appreciate whatever God complex he has, and that's not taking away from a team, because I feel like we built one of the best teams that I've seen or been a part of, but you have to be a little nuts, and you have to have a complex at some level to go you against the world. And maybe God complex isn't how you describe it, but you've got to be nuts.
I think crazy and passionate are fine, but maybe not God. Maybe you want to create a passion that enraptures a lot of other people with you, and not just view yourself as the only person on that pedestal.
It feels like there's sort of a line, though, and I'm wondering if we can define it.
God doesn't operate alone. Without people, it'd be kind of a boring job.
All right, so here's my question to you. Is this something that can be learned, or is it something that is inherent to a person?
What? Can what be learned?
The complex that you're talking about.
I think you're going to get it. You know, we're all somewhere on the scale with eccentricity and you know, when you're in the grind as an entrepreneur, I think you that all comes out. And I don't think you can prepare for it. I think all you can do is be the fastest learner in the building because you have to learn faster than everyone else and work together. But at the same time, you've got to be able to do unpopular things.
The one takeaway from me here, I guess, is that we need people like Steve Jobs and Elon Musk to inspire entrepreneurs to think big and do crazy stuff. But sometimes the myths get twisted on the way to their creation and don't actually reflect the reality. I think we can kind of both agree on that. We have just a few minutes left, and I want you guys to maybe summarize your arguments very briefly, and we'll take our final vote to see who won. So
no one wins.
Everybody wins.
Yeah.
All right, so you guys want to like maybe give a 30-second summary of your thoughts?
I think when people start as entrepreneurs, they invariably are very insecure, and they feel like they have to be this visionary leader, that they have to be a person that other people look up to. Perhaps in earlier versions of my career, I thought that was supposed to be my job as an entrepreneur. Having failed at several early stages of that company, even though we got a small exit, what I learned was probably me trying to act like I was God or me trying to act like I was better than other people didn't build a great bond with those folks. In fact, more often than not, it set me up for failure because I was often wrong. If you act like you're God and you keep telling wrong prophecies, sooner or later your flock's going to desert you. On the other hand, maybe now as I'm a little bit older, or maybe a lot older, I think it's far more important when you're building a company, when you're trying to build a team, to make the story about them and bring them along with you. So I do think you might have to be crazy. I do think you might have to be ambitious or passionate, but the story isn't about you as God. It's about the people that you try and take with you and maybe the thing that you create together.
Yeah. That's lovely.
So that's really good.
Ryan?
I believe, so anytime you have someone who has a lot of scar tissue and they share something like that, if you're an entrepreneur, if you're in any aspect of the world, like, you've got to listen. And so that's actually pretty cool. You can't really build anything without the team. Scaling as a growth strategy, more of your soul, is not a growth strategy. And you're only as good as the sum of your parts. However, when it comes to innovation, not everyone can innovate. Not everyone is a creator. Henry Ford asked people what they wanted, and they said they wanted a faster horse. So at some point, someone needs to stand up. If I was designing a new website, I would never try to have consensus-based decision-making. In reality, is most tech innovation is iterative, and so it's pointing in a direction and saying, this is where we're going, or getting a group together and say, this is where we're all going, and then together as a team, you iterate. And so, look, I think, like I said from the beginning, I don't know if it's a God complex, because that puts a negative connotation in here, but doing startups and building a business is hard. It's probably the hardest thing to do. The easy way in life is just to go take a government job and minimum wage or whatever it is and retire. This is a hard thing to do, and you've got to be a little special and a little nuts.
God, thank you. Okay, we have 30 seconds left. Let me see a show of hands. Who agrees with Dave that no, you do not need a God complex? All right, I can't count that, but.
It's 2,700.
And who agrees with Ryan that you do need a God complex?
So we'll tally these up and come back to you sometime tomorrow morning.
I actually think it might look like you won, Dave.
I thought Ryan actually won.
Yeah.
All right, well, either way, it was a great debate, and please join me in thanking these guys.
All right, awesome.